spitting your truth to the people. We appreciate you. Next up is Thomas Stevens, who's speaking about No EM. He was born and raised in Downriver in Trenton. He graduated from Trenton High School in 1977, attended University of Michigan Residential College, and graduated with a BA in 1981. He worked and traveled in Europe and the Middle East for a year, then returned to Detroit for law school at Wayne State University in 1982 to 1986. He's been a people's lawyer in Detroit for 27 years, the last five employed by the City Council Research and Analyst Division. Thank you, Thomas. Please. Speak the truth.
Thank you. Is it working? Can you hear me? It's really an honor to
speak. No.
You. All right. Testing? Okay. It's an honor to be speaking here after Will and Rashida and Charity with everybody. You know you're in Detroit when you hear these things. I was asked to speak about the connections between the EMFs, and I don't have to tell you what EMF stands for, thank you, Will, and the Petcoke. And so I guess that I'm supposed to say some things about power, and as Charity and Rashida said, this is some very deep stuff. It's even deeper than environmental justice, and it's even deeper than what people are saying about the Petcoke. So what I wanted to briefly address was three things. One, what is the EMF saying about the Petcoke? Two, what does the Petcoke say about the EMF? And three, what does all that kind of as a combination say about us? And I want to do it as quickly as possible. The first one's easy. What does the EMF say about the Petcoke? Not very much. Because when Stephen Boyle, who's standing here, asked him at his not so very public disinformational meeting on Monday, June 14th or June 12th, whenever it was, he said, well, you know, I heard about that, but I was under the impression they had a permit.
Yep, permitted.
So the truth is, as Rashida mentioned, and I just want to flesh it out a little bit, is they do not have what's called a conditional use permit or a zoning variance. The owners and the lessees of that property, Matty Maroon and his contracting buddies, have the right to have warehouses and storage on that place, but not outdoor storage. And so what one of the sites, the smaller site, was doing was going to the city and trying to get a zoning variance. They went through a hearing and then they said, no thanks, we're not interested in this anymore. So something's going on behind the scenes. Maddie and Marathon and the Port Authority and the others down there have some ideas about what they're going to do, but they realize they're running into a lot of attention. So people need to keep the heat on, raise the noise, and tell people what's going on. So that's what the EMF has to say about the Petco. You know, I don't know much about it. I only know what I read on the papers. I was in the impression it had a permit, which is a lie. So what does the Petco say about the EMF? Well, you know, that's when things start to get real interesting. Because, you know, the EMF is here to deal with the city government budget and to deal with the contracts that have been made for funding purposes over the last several decades to raise funds for the city government. And he's going to deal with all that stuff. You know he's going to deal with that stuff. He says, I got a job and I'm going to do it. But in the meantime, then he says, well, the other thing is it's going to be great for you in Detroit. And, you know, the latest iteration of this is, you know, it's a shame what we have to do to these workers and these pensioners, but it's going to be good for the residents. You know, these guys live by divide and conquer. And, you know, what he's saying when he says it's going to be good for the residents is he's saying we're going to have a thriving, prosperous, sustainable, vibrant city. All the phrases that the developers use these days to try to convince you that, you know, they should be able to use your money to do what they want to do. And then you look at the Petcoke and ask yourself what it says about what's really behind this supposedly thriving, sustainable, vibrant city that they're planning for us. And, you know, that's what it's about. Is Marathon has got a tax abatement, so they're processing tar sands crap into fuel, and this is some crap, this is some byproduct that they can sell to the Koch brothers for all people, for God's sake. And they can store it on this, right by the side of the Detroit River, in a place that should be, if you're talking about sustainability and thriving and development and all that BS, it should be protected and it should be treated as a place for people to go to have a decent quality of life. But instead, they're dumping Petcoke on it. So what does it say about the EMF? It says that he's full of it. That's what it says. And if we don't do something about this, that's what we're going to be facing. So finally, and I thank you for your patience, what does all this say about us? Well, you know, that depends on what the issue is, because the issue really isn't Petcoke. I mean, as Charity said, I think, You know, the issue is really the tar sands. We're talking about a form of energy. We're talking about a form of society, a form of economy that is dependent on fossil fuel energy and high volumes of energy, and that decides what kinds of energy it's going to use and how, based on the fact that somebody could make money off it. And that we've taken this to such an extreme, obscene length that out there in Alberta, they rip the ground out. They go, you know, hundreds of feet down, and they tear out, what is it, 600, 400 pounds of overlay for a barrel of oil or something. And they've created a wasteland out there, and they're poisoning a river, and they're destroying a wilderness. So that's the first stage. And then the second stage is they put in these pipelines and ask the people in Marshall how that goes. They put this corrosive, dirty, destructive stuff in pipelines, and they pipe it all the way down here. And when a pipeline bursts, it's such dirty, heavy, contaminated stuff that they can't even do what they normally do when there's a leak, which is clean it up, which really means pick it up and take it to some poorer, darker community. They can't even do that here. They have to leave it down there. They can't do anything about it. So that stage two is the pipelines. It's destructive when they take it out. It's destructive in the pipelines. And here we see part of stage three. But not only do we see those piles, but we're breathing the emissions, and the people in 48217 in Southwest Detroit in particular are breathing the emissions from this refining process. And it is deadly. You know, they're creating way more carbon pollution. They're creating all kinds of pollution in the intensive chemical-dependent process that they use to create fuel from tar sands crap. And then, you know, so that's the third stage, is the refining here. And it's death all the way. And then you get to the real problem. You get to the fourth stage where they burn it. And they're destroying the climate. And we now know they're destroying the climate. And during the same two-month period when these piles were growing and people in Windsor were going, oh, my God, what is that stuff over there? And media from around the world was looking at it and saying, what does this mean that there's these giant black piles of Petcoke on the southwest quadrant of Detroit right next to the river? What is this all about? During that same time frame, you had what? The sensors that measure carbon dioxide in the atmosphere registering over 400 parts per million for the first time in 3 million years. When there were no people here. You had tornadoes in Tornado Alley in Oklahoma. Well, what's new about tornadoes in Tornado Alley, Oklahoma? These were described as having the force of nuclear bombs. They, you know, come in and just rip the ground out and destroy town after town. And we know now that it's virtually a statistical impossibility that the severity and the frequency of these destructive storms, as much as they're happening, could be caused by anything other than global climate change. So that's the real issue, sisters and brothers. We have to find a different way to live. And the tar sands piles, which we're going to march to, which we should march to, and which I commend people for complaining about, are the visible signs of what's really going on. This is a fight for survival. We're all in it together, and thank you for coming and listening.
Yeah.